Okay, we're going to do a channeling session and we're going to channel a friar. I'm a Franciscan friar that has been trained in Rome. He's a man of several languages: French, English, Latin, Italian, and some Spanish. He ended up being an interpreter quite a bit. And everybody really enjoyed this friar. He was kind and giving, and he was respectful, and he was, I think, truly a man of God. And he knows about the Vatican girl, Emanuela. And so he came forward to me. I thought it was her father. And let me tell you a little bit about what happened several weeks ago. I was in sleeping and I heard some sounds coming out of my kitchen, which is where my back door is. But I woke up and I just listened to see if I heard footsteps. So, and I didn't. But I heard rustling, and so I, for some reason, I didn't get up and check it out. So when I got up the next morning, at the back door, I have these special tennis shoes that I wear outside in case they get dirty, and I just take them off at the back door inside. And it was funny because I was talking to my twin that night, and I was sitting on the floor, facing the kitchen. And I remember staring at these shoes, and I know exactly how they were positioned. So they were positioned on the back door mat, and which I always put them on the mat. And when I got up in the morning, they were tousled. They were like someone had kicked them across the floor in the kitchen, and they were like on their side. So it's like someone opened the door and kicked them out. But my door has three locks on it. It has like a deadbolt, it has a chain, and it has a door lock. So if someone's going to come in, I'm going to hear them trying to get in. And the door was still locked. Then that next night, a woman woke me up saying, "Ducha, ducha," which I don't know what that means. We looked it up. We were trying to figure out the spelling of it. And the woman's voice was very beautiful. It was a very beautiful voice. And she was like trying to wake me up saying, "Ducha, ducha." And at first I thought she was saying dude, calling me dude. But then as I was waking up, I heard the cha, ducha. So the pronunciation was on the dude and cha. So I realized that I had watched Vatican Girl the day before the shoes were kicked across the room. So I had a feeling that this had something to do with her. So I asked my rods, "Is this girl still alive?" And they said, "Yes, she is alive." And that she was taken, and the Vatican Church was involved. And when I say the Vatican Church, the Catholic Church, it was those that are a part of the church. And we'll get into that with this friar. She was 15 years old. She was waiting for somebody. She didn't go on her school bus home because she actually lived on Vatican Square. Her father worked, I believe, in the accounting department for the church. There's certain families that do live in the Vatican City, and that they are employed by the Vatican. The Vatican is its own entity, it's its own city, and so they have their own police. Everything is controlled by the Vatican. It governs. She was taken actually right outside the Vatican, but she resided in the Vatican. In Vatican Girl, that's on Netflix, everybody should be watching that and be aware, because I do believe it's true. The truth of, I think, what happened to her is at the very end, and it's semi-true. We're going to cover that, I believe, with this friar. At the end of that, there she had a encounter, a sexual encounter, at age 15, on the grounds of the Vatican. There's a garden area, and I guess she was alone there, and a priest, I believe, approached her maybe more than once while she was there, and did sexual advances towards her, or showed himself to her and wanted her to do something. And because she actually did tell a friend this story, and then it was kind of hush hush, but this friend came out and felt bad about it that she didn't tell anybody. And this girl's name is Emanuela. I want to thank you for letting me speak. I will not give my full name to you because my name is Edgar. I am changing my tune of voice. I am deceased. I was 40 years old when Emanuela was taken. I was in Rome at the time that she was taken. I was a friar, priest. I had served the church in many countries, including my own. I was fervent in who I was and my dedication to God. But through the time of my service, I saw many evil things through whom I serve and through what I serve and through who I hold at the highest hierarchy of the church, whom you think is as high as God. I did see this girl. I actually came to know this girl after she was taken, unfortunately. I was with a sect of friars on Rome at the Vatican. We were in training for many things, and we were of service. I was assigned to the lower catacombs of the church. There's many secrets down in the lower catacombs of the church. The catacombs exist throughout underneath the whole city of Vatican Square. So you can see how vast it is because it's of its own entity. And it does extend out into the Rome under the streets. It is ancient. It was made in medieval times. And my job was to take care of it and clean it and make sure everything was in its place. I was a very studious friar, priest. We wear brown robes. We wear plain clothes underneath. We want for nothing and we have nothing. We are to serve the church and God. For if we serve the church, we serve God in our minds. There was 42 of us that were assigned to the lower catacombs of the church. They found out soon that I was talented. I was very talented in speech and linguistics and very great in communication and pleasant. So after 6 months of serving down in the catacombs of the church and cleaning them thereof, I rose to be more seen and helpful on the grounds of the Vatican. I became a keeper of some of the higher priests. And when I say keeper, I would tend to them, some of the older priests and the elders. I would clean them and bathe them if need be. I'd take care of their rooms. I would also take care of their clothing and ornate this is where I came into trouble, for I saw things that no priest should ever see or know or do. I did not participate, but I saw. Even if it was a glimpse, I saw her. There are children there in the Vatican. There's children that stay in the catacombs, which I did not see, but they were there. Unfortunately, there is a ring of sexual predators in the Vatican. For you see, you have very many men, very many men, and those men do not control themselves at all, which was surprising to me, for I had men advance to me. Did not even matter the age they were, they came at me, and I refused them, for I said, I am of God, and I am celibate. And I will stay celibate. You will have to kill me first. And they would laugh at me and move on. One night, I was in a large room where the priests needed my service. There's many of them in this room. It was almost like a party feeling. I was very confused. They were drinking wine. They were laughing and having a good time. There was a dozen or so of them. They were dressed in the red robes. I was very confused that this type of hierarchy would put on the red robes, which was not meant for them. It was a different robe than I had ever seen before. And they then became quiet, and one man stood in the center of the room with a staff, and he hit the staff on the ground 3 times. I was confused. I had never seen or heard of anything like this before. When he hit the ground 3 times, all the priests, and I'm calling them priests, I am not gonna say their stature, because I will not disclose that. Also, they would go into a circle around this man, as they are all in red, with red gloves, red gowns, with big gold chains. The man in the center had on, in my mind, like the Pope's hierarchy hat, in red. And then it happened. They brought in children. I would say of all ages. I would say 7 to 15. And that is where I saw her, Emanuela. They brought her in. I will not tell you what I saw there. I am showing it to this vessel. And it is sad. Each child stood in front of one of these men. And that is all I will say. I witnessed it. I didn't know what to do. There were several of us friar priests that were there to serve them, and we didn't know what to do. I let it happen. I did not watch. I put my eyes to the floor. I heard the cries. I wanted to cry myself. I wanted to. I didn't know. I was so confused. The next day, I stripped myself naked. And I gave myself lashings on my back for penance for the crimes that I had seen and how I did nothing. I took the punishment and the sorrows of all those children upon myself. The one that I saw that was closest to me was Emanuela. And she stared at me with eyes so sad and so scared. And she looked at me to help her. I cast my eyes away, could not watch. But I said in my mind, I will never forget this girl. I will somehow make this right. I reported this event to the highest authorities. Come to find out that the police of Vatican are as corrupt as these men were, because they also were involved in things of crime against humanity and children. There is so much fornication in those walls. So much that is against the whole teachings of the church. If the people only knew the evil that resides in the walls, you would not be a member of the parish any longer. But I still believed, for the church is an old church. It was raised by on God. It just is lost, and the evil has crossed its doors in the most heinous ways. I investigated. I kept my mouth shut after I reported it and knew it would go nowhere. And I chose to find Emanuela. And I searched and I searched. And I did find her after 3 years. It took me 3 years to track her down. I found her name because she was very public. Her disappearance became very public, and so they kept her hidden very well, and they transferred her to different places. As you see, there is children sex rings that not only is a church involved in, but also the Italian mafia. Luciano is one of the main that would take children and bring them to the church. I was able to, because I was in the room that night, and that I casted my eyes down and I stayed, they trusted me with their evilness. And so, as I inquired throughout time, I found the rooms that the children were kept in, the down below Vatican City. There was rows of either cages, like kennels, like dogs, or there was catacombs, like a jail cell. There were showers. And there was even a kitchen that would feed them all. They cooked below for the children to keep them in a healthier state. The church did not want to kill them. They just wanted to abuse them and rape them. Unfortunately, due to some of the conditions and the drugging of the children, because they would drug them if they got out of control, some got sick. There was those that tended to them, but some did not make it. Due to the conditions, it was cold down there. And it was dark most of the time with low light. The cleansing facilities were not there. and they get sick. Emanuela survived. Unfortunately, she was favored by a few priests, even by the cardinals, that they sinned against God, as they sinned against her. My heart is low, and I was fearful. But the only way I could redeem myself was to save this girl at the peril of my own life. So for 3 years, I followed where they put her, and she was involved in these parties, in these tainted rituals that they would have. It was becoming more and more obvious that there were crimes inside these walls. There came a day that there was a, I don't know if I can tell you, but there was a great change in the Pope that day. Everybody was in one area. It gave me opportunity to grab her and bring her to a designated car that other friars were working with me. We were going to save one child at a time, and she was my first. I had, since I traveled to many places, I was a friend to many convents, many friends to many sisters that knew of these crimes, because the crimes were also committed against them. Fortunately, nuns were abused. Just about every nun would say that a time in her life as being a nun, she had to put up with abuse. And there's nothing that she could do unless she left. And so they would talk to me about these crimes. And I did find a convent that would hide her up. So we took her that day. It was actually quite easy. I knew God was with us that day. His light shone on me and the other friars and some outside sources that helped us. And we put her in the car and she drove away. And she looked back at me as to say thank you. I was trying to repair myself, for I felt that those crimes that they committed were mine. She was taken to the convent, and she was let known that if she said anything to her family or tried to contact them, they would probably be all killed, which the mafia would have made sure, because she was so popular and well known throughout the world of her missingness, her disappearance, that they would have killed her family and made it look like accident. That's how evil these people are. And so she remains safe to this day. She is older woman now. And the nuns that she lives with have kept her safe and hidden. She's healthy and she's alive. And she has repaired from the crimes against her because the nuns that take care of her also have been abused. And they try to live as happy as they can. And she is hid up for the rest of her life, unfortunately. But she is alive. And she is safe. Came a day where we were able to get more children out. In my life, I was able only to save four, only four out of dozens. It was heavily guarded. We did not have much opportunity. And then it word got out who we were and what we were doing in saving the children. And so I was moved. We were disbanded and moved because they found out of our justice. We wanted justice. I told everyone that I came in contact that there's evilness in Vatican City. There's evilness underground and above ground. That there are those men from the cardinal down, and was the Pope. The Pope knew about it, and my fear is was involved in it. I never forgave myself because I did not share it with the outside world. I shared it inside where I lived with the friars. The priests, the bishops, no one would allow me to speak. And so I gave myself penance every day, every day. I would whip myself and feel the pain of the sashes. And each time I felt pain, I saw a child. And now I have died and I have walked in a garden and I have cried at the feet of Christ to forgive me for my sins. Because I couldn't help the children, and I felt I was the sinner for not helping them. There will come a day, I know this now, that there will come a day. Well, the walls of this Vatican Church will crumble. The earth will shake with great fierceness, and the walls will be cracked. And all the beauty of the inside of the church will be dismantled, and a dark cloud will hover just over Vatican City. And that dark cloud will stay there. And it will be like a black fog that has meaning and purpose. And it goes into the doors and windows. And it looks at those cardinals in the face. And it tells them it's their time. It's their reckoning. That their crimes will be exposed now. That they are coming to expose you to the world. This is the end. It will be the end of any pope that will reside upon the earth. It'll be the end. After the church falls, you will see light in the Catholic Church. The good priests, bishops, cardinals, those good men that stood their ground for the sanctified love of God and service to man. They will raise the church out of the rubble, and they will make it good and pure as it was at the very beginning. I must tell you these things, for they are true. I have seen it with my eyes. I was only able to save 4 children out of dozens. Only 4. And those children are safe. And they are in convents. I thank you, people, for trusting me on this time with this vessel. I was the one that kicked her shoes, and she thought it was the father of Emanuela, for she doesn't know my church language. When I say father, that is who I am. Now she understands. She understands this Catholic man that stands in front of her, plain, whom just wanted to serve God because of his love for God. And he got trapped in a prison of evil. And then he looked away. There will be people that will come forth now that will speak the truth. There will be nuns that will speak the truth. There will be no more popes. Mark my words, that there will be a day that it will be done. And Vatican City will be dismantled. And it will become a museum. All the priests, cardinals, and pope will be gone or arrested and jailed. Thus they should be. They are not fooling anybody. They have their rituals and their sex scenes, but they are not fooling anyone because God sees it all. And I will stand as a witness when they cross over. And I will bear testimony of their crimes. For I have seen them. And their judgment will be strong. And it will be fierce. And they should be scared because they will live in the abyss of hell because of these crimes, because of who they were and the advantage that they took because of their title from the top of the church down. Shame on you. For those that listen to this, change your ways. And the only way you can regain favor in God is if you expose yourself. Turn yourself in. And then you may receive a little mercy. But I am here now. And I am strong. And I stand by God. And I stand by Jesus. And I will be your judgment now. We end this transmission.